Thank you so much for joining us on the last week of our vintage Christmas stocking knit along. Make sure to follow along on the blog as there's more information there. So where we left off, we were shaping the gusset, and then we started knitting the foot. But now we want to measure, and when we measure, we want to make sure that our fabric is nice and flat. So lay it out, make sure it still has some stretch to it, but don't stretch it while you're measuring. So once your fabric is nice and flat, we can start measuring. Now we're going to measure from the color change, not from the edge of the stocking. So that's something that's in some of the vintage patterns, is it's kind of hard to understand where to measure from. It's from the color change. And we want to do about 7 inches. So we're at about 7 inches now. So once we hit 7 inches, what we're going to do is we have 2 more rows left to knit. Here we're going to knit 23, knit 2 together, knit 24, and then in the next row we're going to purl to the end. So we're running through it super quick, end up with 48 stitches. You can see that we're finished with our main color. We won't be knitting that again. You should have a little bit left. Using our contrasting color, and with the right side facing, we're going to start decreasing in the toe and then work the Kitchener stitch. And that's going to seam it up. I'm going to begin row 1 with a knit 9. Okay, so we knit 9, we're going to knit 2 together, knit 2, 1, and 2, and then we're going to do a PSSO, so slip 1, knit 1, and pass the slip stitch over and sliding it off the needle. We're going to knit 18. Then we're going to continue with knitting 2 together, knit 2, 1, and 2, and then we're going to do the same, slip 1, knit 1, and pass slip stitch over. You should have 9 stitches left on your needle. We're going to knit to the end. And then when we finish, we're going to start row 2. Row 2 and every alternate row is just going to be a purl to the end. So all of your even rows is just a purl. Row 3, we're going to knit 8. Notice the decrease in the amount of stitches. Then we're going to knit two together. Knit two. And then we're going to do our slip one. Knit one. And pass a slip stitch over. And knit 16. Knit two together. Knit two. Slip one. Knit one. And then pass a slip stitch over. You should have 8 stitches left on the needle to knit. Working row 4, you're just going to purl to the end. Row 5, you're going to knit 7. You can start to see the decreases in the fabric here. Knit two together. Knit two. Slip one, knit one, and pass a slip stitch over. Knit 14. Again, your decreases are showing up. Knit 2. and slip one, knit one, pass the slip stitch over. Knit the last 7 stitches and you should have 36 stitches total on your needles. Row 6, you're just going to purl to the end. Row 7, you're going to knit 6. Knit 2 together. Knit 2. Slip 1, knit 1, and pass the slip stitch over. Next, you're going to knit 12. Going to knit 2 together, knit 2, slip 1, knit 1, and pass the slip stitch over. And then there should be 6 stitches left to knit in row 7. We've decreased by 4 in every odd row, so now you should have 32 stitches total on both of your needles. Row 8, we just purl to the end. Row 9, we're going to knit 5. Going to knit 2 together, knit 2, slip 1 stitch, knit 1, and pass the slip stitch over. So next we're going to knit 10. knit two together, knit two, slip one stitch, knit one stitch, and pass the slipped stitch over. You should have 5 stitches left to knit in this row. Decreasing by 4, you should have 28 stitches total on both needles. For our alternate row, row 10, we're going to just purl to the end. Just a few rows left with row 11, we're going to knit 4. Knit 2 together. Knit 2. Slip 1, knit 1, and pass the slipped stitch over. Now we're going to knit 8. Going to knit 2 together. You can see your decreases there. Knit 2. Slip 1. Knit 1. And pass the slipped stitch over. We've got 4 stitches left in this row to knit. When finished, we've decreased by 4, and you should now have 24 stitches total. Row 12, we're just going to purl to the end. Row 13. Row 13, we're going to knit 3. Row 13, we're going to knit 3. Knit 2 together. Knit 2, slip 1, knit 1, and pass the slipped stitch over. We'll knit 6, knit 2 together, knit 2, slip 1, knit 1, and pass the slipped stitch over. You should now have 3 stitches left to knit in this row. and when finished, decreasing by 4, you should have 20 stitches left on both needles. Row 12, we're just going to purl to the end. Row 15 is the last row in shaping the toe. We're going to start by knitting 2. We're going to knit 2 together. Knit 2. Slip 1, knit 1, and pass the slipped stitch over. We're then going to knit 4, knit 2, knit 2 together, knit 2, slip 1, knit 1, and pass the slipped stitch over. Finishing, you should have 2 stitches left to knit and 16 stitches left in this row. And we have finished shaping the toe, we're going to move on to seaming the toe. So let's take a look at what our stocking will look like when it's finished being seamed. That gives us a good idea of how we are going to turn the work so we can seam it. With the wrong side facing you, you will need 2 stitch holders to seam the toe. Now, wrong side facing you, place the first 4 stitches onto a stitch holder. Slip the next 8 stitches onto the needle that is not in use. Now slip the last 4 stitches onto the next stitch holder. This is how your stitches should now be arranged. So we're going to turn our stitch holders inward. This changes which stitches are on the end of our needles. Okay, so now we have 8 stitches on each of these 2 needles, and they're all lined up and ready for grafting. So when we're doing their grafting, we're going to work the Kitchener stitch, and we will show you how to do that next. So again, cutting a long tail, just because that's what we do. We have plenty of yarn to work with. Before starting that, I like to make sure that my stitches are lined up with each other. It just makes it easier when we're working in visualizing how the stitches come together. Because essentially when we start grafting, we want to mimic the same stitch pattern that we have going throughout our stocking. For this next part, you will need a darning needle. And then you're gonna, again, line up your stitches so they match each other for the Kitchener stitch. So you're going to go into the opposite stitch. We're just starting here. And bring that through. And pull the yarn through. And then you're going to go back through the first stitch on the needle closest to you. And the next one over. So you're always going to work through 2 stitches at a time, with the exception of the first one we were just setting it up. Going through the first stitch and second stitch on the opposite needle, the needle furthest away from you. And then typically we would slide the first stitches off of both needles, but I wanted you to see how we work it across. So I left those on there. So now we're going to go into the second stitch and the third stitch of the needle closest to you. And then we'll go through the second stitch and the third stitch of the needle opposite or furthest away from you. So now we'll do third and fourth of the needle closest to you. Third and fourth of the needle furthest from you. Fourth and fifth of the needle closest to you. Fourth and fifth of the needle furthest from you. If you notice, we're always working from left to right here. in the instructions, it talks about inserting your needle knit-wise and pulling it through purl-wise. Moving while your stitches are on the needle, moving left to right does the same. So we're just repeating this until we have seamed through every stitch on our needles. If you haven't pulled your needles out, this is when you do it. So take a look at what our stitches look like now. See, there's no seam, and they match up with each other pretty well. And then just work your yarn around to the seam for seaming. Next is the mattress stitch. This is how we're going to seam our stocking. This is how we're going to seam up the back of our stocking. To show you, I'm using a contrasting color. That way you can see what the yarn looks like through the seaming. And then I'm also using Mary Max and Titan, which is a size 5 bulky. You'll be able to see the stitches a little bit better this way. So I'm threading my darning needle. Notice I'm pulling apart the plies and then working the yarn in the needle. Okay, so the important thing about the mattress stitch is in locating and identifying the bars. I'll zoom in here. So you see the bar down below, and then if I tease this apart, you can see the additional bars from behind. Essentially, they're these bars that are in between your knit stitches, or the purls at the back end of your knits. We're going to start by seaming through the very bottom stitch of each row. So we're going to start by going through the very bottom stitch of the first piece and through two bars on the second piece. And then we're going to go through back over to the first piece and go through two bars. So when you're going through the bars, you always want to go through the previous bar that you worked on that piece and the next one. So we're going to go through the last bar here and the first bar of the next one. Again, they're like these bars here in the middle of your stitches. So we've located and identified the last bar that we went through, then we locate the next one. So you can see that there. Now I'm pulling through and seaming really loosely so you can see everything that I'm doing here. As I continue, I'll go loose and then we'll tighten it up. The important thing to think about is you want to match the tension in the fabric. So you don't want it to be too tight, you don't want it to be too loose. You want it to look seamless, like there isn't a seam. So again, we're going through the previous bar and identifying the next bar and seaming through that. You can see that bar here. So easy to split your yarn when you're using a darning needle. Again, your previous bar, and then the next bar. So we'll speed it up here in just a minute. So you can pull tight as you go, but you can't pull the whole thing tight. So make sure you're adjusting your tension as you work. It is much easier to adjust it as you work versus adjusting it all at the end. Okay, we're going to go a little faster here. Again, when you work the mattress stitch, your goal is to match the tension of your fabric. So you can see here, I've worked it a little bit more tight. You can see where the gap was down below. Kind of skipped ahead a little bit. So go ahead and work up the sides of your stocking. A good idea is to place some stitch markers where you have color changes. That way you can tell if you've made some mistakes and it's not matching up. And we've left you plenty of spots to seam back and forth and to tie off your yarn with all these really long tails. Seam them up, seam them together, and then trim your yarn pieces. So just finish up tying up these ends, and there you have it. We want to thank you so much for joining this vintage Christmas stocking knit along. We know you've been so incredibly patient with us that we are so thankful for, and we hope that you are very proud of what you've done. I know a lot of new knitters are stumbling upon these tutorials. We also encourage you to visit our website. There are so many vintage Christmas stockings available for as downloadable patterns at marymaxim.com. We hope this has inspired you to pick up the needles and take part in some of these traditions that have been part of so many families for decades. We would love to see your work. Make sure you share it with us on our social media profiles and follow along for the next tutorial series. These will go a little bit faster now. Again, we were trying to be super detailed with the stocking series, as so many brand new knitters are inspired to pick up the needles, as this tradition has been passed down from generation to generation through the years and through the decades. And we are just so excited to be a part of that with you. Thank you so much, and happy crafting!